bones of the upper limb. The upper limb is connected to the axial skeleton, which is cranium, vertebral column, and associated thoracic cage by a bony pectoral girdle at the sternoclavicular joint, which is the connection between the clavicle and sternum. Each upper limb is made up of 32 bones and has different regions. First, there is pectoral girdle, which consists of two bones, the scapula, also called the shoulder blade, and the clavicle, also known as a collarbone. Then there is the arm, which only has one bone, called humerus. Then we have the forearm, which has two bones, called the radius and ulna. Next, there is the wrist, which has 8 carpal bones, and finally the hand, which has 5 metacarpal bones, and the fingers, who have 14 phalanges in total. Now we will talk about shoulder girdle first. The shoulder girdle consists of scapula and clavicle and articulates interiorly with the manubrium of the sternum. Starting with the scapula, it's a flat triangular bone located on the posterior aspect of the shoulder, extending over the second to the seventh ribs. The scapula helps to connect the rest of the upper limb to the trunk while stabilizing and assisting the shoulder during movement, while serving as an attachment point for numerous muscles and ligaments. Now, like any fine triangle, the scapula has three borders. The shortest and thinnest of them is superior border. Then there is the medial border, which runs parallel to the vertebral column. And finally, there is the lateral border, which is the thicker one. The lateral border is also known as the axillary border because it's point toward the axilla or armpit region. The point where the medial and lateral border meet is the inferior angle, and we also have the superior angle, which is the junction of superior and medial borders. At the lateral part of the superior border, there is a small indentation called scapular notch through which the suprascapular nerve passes. Immediately lateral to the notch, the scapula has a bony projection called coracoid process, which is this bony hook that first projects interiorly and then curves toward the lateral side, similar to the bent finger. The coracoid process serves as an attachment point for the four structures, including the coracoacromial ligament, the pectoralis minor muscle, the coracobrachialis muscle, and the short head of the biceps brachii. Okay, now the anterior surface of the scapula has a wide depression called subscapular fossa, which is where the subscapularis muscle attaches. If we flip the scapula over, we can see its posterior surface. Below the superior border, there is a prominent ridge of the bone called spine of the scapula, which becomes broader as it extends laterally and superiorly to give rise to the acromion process, or simply the acromion. The surface below the spine of the scapula is called infraspinatus fossa, where infra means below and spinous referring to the spine of the scapula. This is where a muscle called infraspinatus attaches. The space above the spine is called the supraspinous fossa, and as you might have guessed it, it is an attachment point for the supraspinatus muscle. The spine of the scapula also has an attachment point for the deltoid muscle on the deltoid tubercle of spine, in addition to attachments for the trapezius muscle. Inferior to coracoid process, on the superior lateral surface of the scapula, there is the glenoid cavity, which is a shallow cup-like fossa facing the lateral side. The glenoid cavity fits the head of the humerus to form the glenohumeral or shoulder joint, and the coracoacromial ligament stabilizes this joint. Just above the glenoid cavity, there is a small bony bump called the supraglenoid tubercle, which serves as an attachment point for the long head of the biceps brachii muscle. Again, immediately below the glenoid cavity, there is another bony pump called infraglenoid tubercle, which serves as an attachment point for the long head of the triceps brachii muscle. ओके नाउ द टिप ऑफ द एक्रोमियम आर्टिकुलेट्स विद द लेटरल एंड ऑफ एस शेप्ड बोन कॉल्ड द क्लेविकल फॉर्मिंग द एक्रोमियो क्लेविकुलर जॉइंट विच हेल्प्स विद स्टेबिलिटी एंड मोशन ऑफ द शोल्डर जॉइंट. द मीडियल एंड ऑफ द क्लेविकल इज इन लार्ज एंड ट्राइंगुलर शेप्ड एंड आर्टिकुलेट्स विद द मैनुब्रियम विच इज़ द अपर पार्ट ऑफ द स्टर्नम टू फॉर्म द स्टर्नो क्लेविकुलर जॉइंट. द मीडियल टू थर्ड्स ऑफ द क्लेविकल्स आर कन्वेक्स इंटीरियरली एंड द लेटरल थर्ड इज फ्लैटेंड एंड कनकेव इंटीरियरली. ऑन द इंफीरियर सर्फेस ऑफ द क्लेविकल इमीजिएटली मीडियल टू इट्स लेटरल एंड देर इज अ स्मॉल ओब्लीक रिज ऑफ द बोन कॉल्ड ट्रेपिजोइड लाइन वेयर द ट्रेपिजोइड लिगामेंट अटैचेज. मेडियल टू ट्रेपिजोइड लाइन देयर इज अ कनोइड ट्यूबरकल विच इज़ वेयर द कनोइड लिगामेंट अटैचेज. बोथ द ट्रेपिजोइड एंड द कनोइड लिगामेंट्स हेल्प स्टेबिलाइज द पेक्टोरल गर्डल. फाइनली द इन्फीरियर साइड ऑफ द क्लेविकल हैज़ अ शैलो ग्रूव कॉल्ड द सबक्लेवियन ग्रूव वेयर द सबक्लेवियस मसल अटैचेज. Determining the orientation of the clavicle that the lateral portion is flat and the inferior surface is rough compared to the smooth superior surface. Finally, the clavicle's most important job is to suspend the scapula away from the trunk, allowing the upper limb maximum freedom of the motion. The clavicle is also one of the bony boundaries of the cervico-axillary canal, which is a passageway that extends between the upper limb and the neck. So the clavicle also protects the neurovascular bundles supplying the upper limb. Now let's look at the single bone in the arm, the humerus. The humerus is the largest bone of the upper limb. Proximally, the humeral head articulates with the glenoid cavity to form the glenohumeral joint, while the distal end of the humerus articulates with the radius and ulna distally to form the elbow joint. Laterally to the humeral head, there is a bony protuberance called the greater tubercle, and the anterior to it is the lesser tubercle, which is more on the anterior humerus. The greater tubercle is an attachment point for the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and the teres minor muscles, while the lesser tubercle is an attachment point for the subscapularis muscle between these two tubercles. There is a narrow groove called the intratubercal sulcus or bicipital groove because the tendon of biceps brachii muscle passes through it. Just below the humeral head, there is an anatomical neck of the humerus. This is formed by a groove separating the humeral head from the greater and the lesser tubercle, and is where the glenohumeral joint capsule attaches. Distal to the tubercle, there is the surgical neck of the humerus, which is where the broad proximal part of the humerus meets to the narrow humeral shaft. This makes the surgical neck relatively weaker and thus a common site for the humeral fracture. On the posterior surface of the shaft, there is a shallow but broad bone depression called the radial groove, which is where the radial nerve passes through. On the lateral side of the shaft, there is a rough small bump called deltoid tuberosity, which is where the deltoid muscle attaches. Toward its distal end, the humerus flattens a bit, giving rise to two bony projections known as a medial and lateral epicondyles. Above the lateral epicondyle, there is a lateral supracondylar ridge, which is roughened ridge of the bone where the extensor carpi radialis longus, the brachialis muscle, and the triceps brachii muscles attach. Above the medial epicondyle, there is a medial supracondylar ridge, which serves to attach the medial head of the triceps, the brachialis, and the pronator teres. Finally, the tip of the distal humerus, referred to as the condyle of the humerus, has two articular surfaces, which makes sense as it articulates with the two bones of the forearm, the radius, and ulna. Medially, there is the trochlea, which literally translates to the pulley, which is lucky because it really looks like one. The trochlea articulates with the trochlear notch of the ulna, and laterally there is the capitulum, which articulates with the head of the radius, and it literally means tiny head because it looks like a tiny bald head. It can be difficult to remember which fossa articulates with which bone, so you can try and remember the phrase crazy tulips. CRA in crazy represent the capitulum articulating with the radius, and TUL in the tulips represent the trochlea articulating with the ulna. On the anterior surface of the humerus proximal to trochlea, there is a small depression called the coronoid fossa. Lateral to the coronoid fossa, there is the radial fossa, which sits just proximally to the capitulum. During flexion of the elbow, the coronoid fossa receives the coronoid process of the ulna, while radial fossa is a cozy place for the radial head. If we flip the bone and look on the posterior side, just at the same level, there is a much larger depression called the olecranon fossa, which accommodates the olecranon process of the ulna when the forearm is fully extended. Next up, there is the forearm, which is made up of two parallel bones, the ulna medially and radius laterally. The ulna is main stabilizing bone of the forearm, and at its proximal end, the ulna articulates with the trochlea of the humerus and the head of the radius laterally. To articulate with the humerus, the ulna has two prominent projections, the olecranon, which forms the point of the elbow and sits in the olecranon fossa when the elbow is extended, and the coronoid process, which projects interiorly and fits into the coronoid fossa when the elbow is flexed. These two processes form the trochlear notch, which grips the trochlea like a wrench. Slightly distal to the coronoid process, there is the ulnar tuberosity, a bony bump where the brachialis muscle inserts. On the lateral side of the coronoid process, there is a smooth concavity called the radial notch of the ulna, which articulates with the disc-shaped head of the radius, forming the proximal radio-ulnar joint. The radial head is tied to the radial notch of the ulna by a ring-shaped ligament called the annular ligament. On the lateral side of the ulna, inferior to the radial notch, on the lateral ulna is superior supinator crest. To the radial notch on the lateral ulna is the supinator crest, which is attachment of the deep part of the supinator muscle needed for the forearm supination. Looking at the shaft of the ulna, its lateral side form a long ridge of the bone called the introitus border of the ulna, where the introitus membrane attaches. The introitus membrane, intermeaning between and osseous main bone, is a dense connective tissue that connects the ulna and the radial shaft so that the forearm bones move as one. Distally, the shaft of the ulna ends with the round area called the head of the ulna, which stops short and does not participate in the radiocarpal joint of the wrist. Towards the posterior side of the head of the ulna, there is a small bony projection called the styloid process of the ulna, which is where the ulnar collateral ligament of the wrist attaches. Okay, now let's have a look at the radius, which runs parallel and lateral to the ulna. On the proximal part of the radial head, there is a concave depression for when it articulates with the capitulum of the humerus during flexion and extension. The radial head itself is also disc-shaped in nature, which is important during pronation and supination or turning your forearm from keyboard typing position to the anatomical position. The medial side of the radial head articulates with the radial notch of the ulna, forming the proximal radio-ulnar joint. Immediately below the radial head, there is the narrow radial neck, and distal to it on the medial side, there is an oval-shaped bony protuberance called radial tuberosity. The radial tuberosity has two parts, the posterior one, which is rough, and interior part, which is smooth. The posterior part is where the tendon of biceps brachii muscle inserts. Distal to the radial tuberosity, there is radial shaft, which becomes broader distally and bends slightly towards the medial side. On its medial side, there is the ulnar notch, where part of the ulnar head fits to form distal radio ulnar joint. On its posterior side, the distal radius has a bony prominence called Lister tubercle or dorsal tubercle of the radius, which can be palpated on the dorsum of the wrist. At the tip of the distal radius, there is a smooth, slightly concave surface that articulates with the carpal bones, specifically the scaphoid and the lunate, to form the parts of the radiocarpal joint, commonly called the wrist. On the lateral side of the distal radius, there is a pointed bony projection called a styloid process of the radius, which projects more distally than the ulnar styloid process. So in next lecture we will discuss about the wrist bone. So thanks for watching.